all who are able, please let us rise together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, our refuge, our delight, our beginning and our end.
Amen.
Let us come in truth before the one who loves us and has freed us from our sin. Eternal One, robed in majesty and mercy, we confess that sin has taken hold of us, and we are complicit in its power. We are disturbed in spirit, and our hearts cannot rest. Unbind us and set us free. Lead us again to the waters of rebirth, that we may live just and generous lives for the good of your world, and the care of our neighbors, following in the servant way of Jesus. Amen. These words are trustworthy and true. Christ bore our sins once for all on the cross, swallowing up death forever. For his sake, your sins are forgiven, and God remembers your sins no more. Let your heart be glad again and rejoice in your salvation.
Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the first fruits of the resurrection, grace and peace be with you all.
And also be with you.
I now invite all to search their bulletin to find the order of service entitled The Rite of Remembrance. Blessed be the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation.
God comforts us in all of our sorrows, so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with consolation we ourselves have received from God.
When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death.
We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of God, we too might live a new life.
For if we've been united with Christ in a death like his, we will certainly be united in a resurrection like his.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, those who die in Christ still live with you in joy and blessedness.
We give you heartfelt thanks for the grace you have bestowed upon your servants who have finished their course in faith and now rest from their labors.
Please be seated. Today we remember before God, Bob Gibbs. Dick Keck. Norma Squire. Peggy Sue Comstock. Donald Orr. Susan Rooks. Pat Yopet. Gary Ludwig. Jim Sampson. Tish Sesney. Mike Socash. Betty Sue Young. The last candle we light here today is for all the saints, from the beginning of time until now. Into your hand we commend, O merciful Savior, sheep of your own fold, lambs of your own flock, sinners of your own redeeming.
Eternal rest grant to them, O God, and let perpetual light shine upon them.
And now let us join together in the prayer of the day, which we find printed in our bulletin insert. Almighty God, you have knit your people together in one communion in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant us grace to follow your blessed saints in lives of faith and commitment, and to know the inexpressible joys you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading for this All Saints Sunday is from the 25th chapter of Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read responsively from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who dwell therein.
For the Lord has founded it upon seas and established it upon rivers.
Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord, and who may stand in God's holy place?
Those of innocent hands and purity of heart, who do not swear on God's deity, nor do they pledge by what is false.
They shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of their salvation.
Such is the generation of those who seek you, O Lord, and those who seek your face, O God of Jacob.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O everlasting doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle.
Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O everlasting doors, that the King of glory may come in.
Who is this King of glory? Truly the Lord of hosts is the King of glory.
Our second reading is from the 21st chapter of Revelations. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to John, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had only been here, my brother would not have died." And when Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept him from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. Now it was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, there is already a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." And Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." And when he said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. We are here on this All Saints Sunday not only to remember those saints who have gone on before us, but all of the saints who are among us now. Now, Larry, I'm sure that every time you look at your wife, you say, "Diane, you must be a saint for putting up with me."
Absolutely.
I say the same thing. Who are the saints? I think I've shared with you before that the earliest recollection I have of a saint is my great-grandmother. She was the one who, well, when you would go over her house, she had this immense garden. And every time you went over, she would be out in the garden, but she would be talking to someone. Someone who wasn't there. And if you saw this, you would probably think she was like a little bit out of there. But what we came to find out was that she was talking with God. That was her time to be alone with her Savior. In fact, when we started working with her in her garden, that is where she taught us the Lord's Prayer and the Ten Commandments. While we were digging in the dirt, we learned to give thanks to God for all that he provided. We give thanks to God for the day that we had. We gave thanks for the time that we had with her. You see, the saints are the ones who, well, they help to lead us into the faith. They're the ones, whether it be a relative, a friend, a teacher, a Sunday school teacher, maybe a pastor, someone who has brought Jesus Christ into our lives. Maybe it was for the first time, or maybe it was sometime down the road. Maybe we knew Christ, but we walked away. Maybe something got in the way of our faith. And we had one of God's saints reintroduce us and to welcome us back into that relationship with Christ. You see, our relationship begins at that baptismal font or in a river, in a lake, wherever it is that we are baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It is done with that water element and the words of God himself. It is there that you are claimed as his beloved child. It is there that he begins that relationship with you. And from that point on, we have received that Holy Spirit. And no matter where we go, no matter what we do, no matter what choices we make, God still calls us his beloved child. We have been made saints, whether we like it or not. And no matter how many things that we might do wrong, well, God still considers us his beloved. You can probably think about so many people who have influenced you in life, who have brought you into the faith, who have nurtured you in the faith, who have kept you strong even when times are difficult. In our readings this morning, we hear about a very difficult time. Mary and Martha have lost their brother Lazarus. And Lazarus was someone whom Jesus loved as a best friend. In fact, if we look in the chapters before this, we find out that Jesus had taken his disciples into the region of Philip the Tetrarch because Herod had just killed John the Baptizer. And because it was not yet Jesus' time, he took his disciples over into that area, knowing that Herod would not ever pursue them there. Now Mary and Martha, when Lazarus was sick, sent word to him. And when the message got to him, Jesus did nothing. I'm sure we've had times in our lives when we've prayed to God and we didn't get an answer. In fact, maybe there was silence. Nothing happened. God didn't come. Why did Jesus wait? Well, he told his disciples that this was something that could help to glorify God. Now, how is it that somebody's death could help to glorify God? Well, in this case, Jesus comes, and he eventually gets there. We hear that Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. Now, this is very significant, because the Jews at that time who believed in the resurrection, they believed that after the third day, for 3 days, the soul or the spirit of the person would hang around. But after the end of the third day, it would be gone. So on the fourth day, there would be no hope of that person ever being able to go into God's kingdom. There would never be any hope for them at all. And so on the fourth day, Jesus comes. On that day of impossibility, Jesus arrives. And there he finds people wailing, mourning. Martha and Mary both. And they say to Jesus, "If only you would have been here, our brother would still be alive." I don't know if you can hear the emotion in that line, but I gotta believe there was a lot. That they trusted in Jesus, and yet, when they really, really needed him, he didn't seem to be there. I'm sure we can all identify with that. That there have been times in our lives that we called out, and it just didn't seem like Jesus was there. But he was, and he is. Jesus understands our pain. He understands our anguish. He understands our sadness. He understands all these things because God became flesh, and God walked among us, and God suffered as we suffered. God experienced the joy of the wedding at Cana. He also felt the insults of the Pharisees and the scribes. He enjoyed the time with his disciples, but he also felt the betrayal of those same 12 when they all ran away. Jesus felt the pain of the lash, and of course he experienced death on a cross. That God knows how you feel. God understands. He's felt that pain. He's also felt that same loneliness. When we cry out to God and say, "God, where are you?" Jesus himself on that cross said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" He understands. And that is why we turn to him. That is why we know that whatever may happen, we are not alone. It will happen in God's time, but maybe not in our time. And it will happen in God's way, but maybe not in the way that we hope for. And I'm sure Mary and Martha were thinking just that. Jesus, if only you had been here. So what does Jesus do? Well, he sees the whole community there. And he sees that they are in mourning. And he then begins to weep. The God who created all things, the one who spoke everything into existence, the Alpha, the Omega, God Almighty, weeps. I'll bet you don't know that he does that for you as well. When you cry, he cries. I remember hearing a pastor tell a story about a little four-year-old that his elderly neighbor lost his wife of over 50 years. And he was sitting out on his front porch, and the man just began to cry. Now this four-year-old was on his front porch with his mother, and when this four-year-old looked over and saw the man crying, he got off his chair, went down the steps, and ran over, and he jumped up into the man's lap. And then he sat there, and he just looked up at the old man. And after a few more minutes of this man crying, he looked down at this young boy, and he nodded, and he wiped away the tears, and the young man got down and went back and sat down next to his mother. And the mother said, "What did you say to that man?" And the young boy looked up at his mom and said, "I didn't say anything, Mommy. I just helped him cry." You see, that is how God is with us. He knows how you feel. He understands the pain. He understands the anguish. He knows what you're going through. And he is there. And he was there for Lazarus and Mary and Martha as well. And see, this is the part that we didn't understand, his disciples didn't understand. But outside of that tomb, he does two things. He tells them to roll away the stone. The same words that would be used later on in John's gospel when the disciples and Mary came to the tomb. There was a stone there. And they were wondering who was going to roll that away. But Jesus says, "Let us roll that stone away." And that is when the community that was all there, they rolled it away. And Jesus said a prayer. Now, he didn't pray to God and say, "God, would you heal Lazarus? God, would you bring him out?" Rather, he says, "God, I know that you are my Father in heaven. I want others to know that I am from you and that you are in me and I am in you. I am doing this to glorify your name, but I'm doing this so others might come to believe in you." And then he said, "Lazarus, come out." And Lazarus came out. And then he asked members of that same community to unbind him, untie him, and take the cloth off. I'm sure that Mary and Martha rejoiced, but I also know that there would be another day, somewhere down the road, we are not told, when Mary and Martha would have to go through the very same thing. One day Lazarus would die. And this time, he would not come back. Just as we've experienced that with our loved ones. But what we've also experienced by way of all the saints who have brought us up into the faith, we've experienced the joy that comes from knowing Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. We've come to believe that he is indeed the Son of God and that he came into the world for one purpose. That was for you. That God so loved you that he sent his Son, not to condemn but to save, so that all who believe in him shall have eternal life. That God came so you would know not just life here and now, but you will know it forever with him in his kingdom. You see, too many of us tend to think that we are in the land of the living, and then when we die, we go into the land of the dead. But I would say to you that we are living among the dead, and one day, we shall be living in the world of the living. That we will be in God's kingdom forever. There will be no more pain, there will be no more sorrow, there will be no more anguish. And even better still, We will be around that heavenly banquet table. We will be around that table with our loved ones, our friends, those who have gone before us, and those who will come after us. And there will be joy in heaven. And the best news is, we didn't earn it. We don't deserve it. But God gives it to you simply because He loves you. And that He calls you His beloved children. When He made you His child, He meant that forever. And as I said, no matter how many times we go off the rails, no matter what decisions we may make, you are still loved by God. And in that, we know the forgiveness that comes through that body and blood of Jesus Christ shed for us on that cross. And we are made new each and every time we seek God's forgiveness. God simply says, "My son, my daughter, you are forgiven, and that sin is wiped away." You see, that's what I've learned from the saints that have been in my lives. They're the ones who said that no matter what goes on, Ron, you can count on one thing, that God is with you. And God will be with you every step of the way, even until the end of days. And if you trust in Him, if you believe in Him, no matter what you experience here and now, God understands. And God is with you. And because of that, then we are able to live out our lives with grace, with dignity, with peace, with love. We are able to bear the fruits that God calls us to bear. That we are able to love even in the midst of pain, even in the midst of suffering. We are able to share this good news with everyone that we encounter. And hopefully it is with our actions more so than our words. But it is because we trust, we believe. And the only way we come to do that is by those who have nurtured us in the faith, those saints who have gone on before us, and those saints who may be sitting in the pew right next to us, the ones that God has chosen to put into our lives, knowing that we would need them. Maybe not now. But there will come a time. And for them, I give thanks, just as I give God thanks for each and every one of you. And so we celebrate all the saints, whether we think that of ourselves or not. In the eyes of God, you are not only a saint, but most importantly, you are His beloved son or daughter.
Thank you.
confess our common faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rooted in God's abundant love for the world, let us pray for our neighbors, the church, and all of creation. O God of resurrection, you call us by name and raise us to life. Rouse your church from slumber. Where we have held back in fear or shame, unbind us. Embolden us in our proclamation of your good news, that all may know abundant life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
O God of creation, you have founded your world on rivers and seas. Preserve fresh water sources and the creatures who call them home. Heal places of pollution and nourish places of drought. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
O God of the earth, you reign over all nations and peoples. Inspire us with wisdom and discernment as we elect religious leaders and leaders. May they govern with justice and uphold the dignity of all people. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
O God of heaven, you make your home among mortals. Come alongside those who weep this day. Befriend all who are lonely, encourage those in despair, and heal any who are suffering. Abide with your faithful ones in love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
O God who serves, you set before us a feast of rich food. Sustain our ministries of fellowship and hospitality. Strengthen the hands and hearts of all who prepare and serve food for our nourishment. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
O God, Alpha and Omega, we give thanks for your faithful ones who are now at peace with you. With all your saints, we praise you, for you have swallowed up death forever. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we do approach your throne humbly, knowing that it is only through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, that we are able to do so. We ask this day, Father, for your healing, your restoration to wholeness, your comfort, your guidance. But most of all, Father, we ask for your presence in the lives of those we now name out loud. Father, we lift up to you today Eloise, Fran, Sue, Debbie, Hazel, Vera, Gabe, Michelle, Mervin, Madeline, Mary, Tina, Patty, Mike, Kathy, Ainsley, Matthew, Sam, Bill, Evelyn, Trevor, Vienna, Margaret, Natalie, Sam, Damon, Sandra, June, Avis, Pat, Renetta, Marlene, Alan, Elaine, Linda, Betty, Dar, Bob, Erzabeth, Betsy, Rosa, Sue, Connie, Rick, Roger, Lucas, Dick, Pastor John, Matt, Tom, Marge, Cheryl, David, Braden, Betty Lou, Kathy, John, Ashley and her family. Father, we pray for your son, Rich, and we pray so much that he continues to live out his life in faith, trusting that you are with him, knowing that you will guide him along the way, that whatever healing, restoration to wholeness might look like, that he trusts it is according to your will and in your time. And Father, we lift up to you Ron, our brother in Christ, and we pray, Father, for his healing, for his restoration. Give him strength, give him all that he needs so that his life might be one of peace, of joy, that he's able to spend many, many years with his loved ones. Father, we lift up all who are suffering through any types of addictions. We pray for them and their families, that they may know that in Christ Jesus there is healing, there is wholeness, there is forgiveness, that Father, in you all things are possible. We lift up to you, Father, our brave men and women who serve in our military, our first responders, our frontline workers. We ask, Father, that as they go about their days, that you go with them, protect them, watch over them, and guide them, and bring them safely home to their loved ones. And Father, especially during this time of the year, when we are about to elect new people to govern us, help us to remember, Father, that we are your children, and as your children, that as followers of Christ Jesus, that we are to love one another. We are to love even those who might oppose us. That, Father, we should bear good fruits worthy of our repentance. That hate and slander and evilness should have no place in our lives. That we should not be the ones slinging arrows. We should not be the ones tearing down. But that we, as followers of Christ, are peacemakers and bridge builders. That we are to reach out even to those who are our enemies with love. Father, help us to remember whose we are. Help us to remember, Father, that we are your children. And as your children, Father, we follow you and no one else. Help us to live out our calling in this world. Help us to raise up the saints in this life. Help us follow Jesus Christ all the way. Let us pick up our crosses and follow after him. We offer our prayers to you, gracious God, trusting in your boundless love for all that you have made through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
And now may the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in that same peace.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, our portion and our cup, you offered yourself in love for the world, and in this meal you nourished us with your life. Fill us with your abundance, that we may feed the hungry and welcome the stranger, trusting in your name. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the witness of your saints, you show us the hope of our calling and strengthen us to run the race set before us, that we may delight in your mercy and rejoice with them in glory. And so with all your saints, with the choirs of angels, with the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also for the remembrance of me." Remembering therefore his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, this body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Faithful God, you have spread before us a feast of rich food and drink in the body and blood of your Son. Now send us out to labor with you in full service to the world you have made and among the people you have made your home. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
O God, you have called your servants, adventures of which we cannot see ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.